You know, it is an amazing thing when you begin to allow the Holy Ghost to do what He wants to do, and that is to begin to fill your emotions with God. People go after things that have nothing to do with the kingdom of God because they're empty inside emotionally. By and large, your whole being exists and is defined by emotions. Now, I know Aristotle didn't believe that. I know Socrates didn't believe that. I know Plato and Philo did not believe that. But God believes that. And He describes it in His Word and describes to you and I who we are. And just tells us how He wants us to be filled with joy. And in the moment you make that non-emotional, then I'm going to really be concerned about your awareness of life. Because joy is nothing more than a glorious emotion. Hallelujah. Anamestikeia and amosataranaya is love. Such the same peace. Hallelujah. And Papa wants us to be so filled with the riches of His life. The riches of the quality of His life. I've had people stand in front of me before and say, you know, look, I'm going to tell you, I don't really understand why you guys feel so, you know, are so keen on eternal life because my existence is terrible and I want it to end. I said, well, you know, I've said this at times, you know, I understand exactly what you mean and how you feel. But 1 second in His presence and you'll never want it to end. So let's have that second right now. 1 second, let's have that second right now. And then when you start living second to second in His glory, hallelujah, minute to minute in His glory, it'll grow into hour to hour in His glory. Then it'll grow into day to day in His glory. Hallelujah. And you'll find yourself living in the Spirit and walking this, living in the Holy Ghost. It's a quality of life. It's not just a quantity of time. Eternal life is the very life and substance of Jesus Christ, the very life and substance of the Holy Ghost, the very life and substance of God Almighty. Who can comprehend His utterances? They far supersede the comprehension and understanding of man. Eliphaz said that to Job. The doctrine of Job is actually very good. It's just misapplied. Do you understand me? If you've never made a study of the doctrines of Job, do so. It'll take you a couple of years, but it's a worth 2 years worth spending. I love the doctrine of God because it takes me into a place of understanding who He is, His mind, His heart. I pray in Jesus' name that every one of you just enjoy being with the Father. You begin to understand what it's like. Look, I'm looking for... Look, we're heading someplace good. I'm going to tell you right now. It won't take you more than 100 years to break the barrier. Because within 100 years, everybody here is going to have crossed over. Everyone here is going to have crossed over. You're going to break the barrier. You're going to be into another realm. You're going to be there face to face. Somebody said, what's heaven like? Well, heaven to me is like the Garden of Eden, but Christ Jesus and all the saints gathered around in the glorious, most wonderful culture that supersedes anything in the history of humanity. You can conceptualize it just for a moment with Adam and Chava, or Adam and Eve in the garden. But with Father there running around saying, it's time to dance. See, the Spirit of the Lord came at the cool. God the Father came, the Scripture says, in the cool of the day, moving. He came in, literally, it says this, He came in the spirit of the day, moving to His Spirit. Literally, it says that, honestly. What a dance. Zephaniah 3:17, He rejoices over you in the dance. I pray that you can get so excited about Him today. We'll teach you how to dance. Huh? As the Holy Ghost has taught us. Amen. And then we'll just hand you right on off to the Holy Ghost after we show you a couple of steps, and He'll take it from there. Amen. We just show you a couple of steps just to get you moving in the right direction. That's it. Just like we declare the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, just to get you moving in the right direction. You call upon the name of the Lord and you're saved. I could just worship all day. I could worship all day if I could sing. Just that sometimes when you start worshiping, you just can't do nothing, can't say nothing. So, just too deep, isn't it? Just too wonderful. Papa's about ready to do something great through you. Won't you cooperate with them? Don't faint at the last moment. Don't weary at the last moment. Don't give up at the last stretch. Huh? You put in the 12th mile, now right into the 13th mile. Don't faint. Come on now. Just push it out. I know you're tired. I know you're weary. I know that your muscles are cramping. I know that you feel like you can't go on, that everything in every cell in your body is about to explode. But come on, just push through. Come on, you're not going to die. You're not going to die. Just having done well, don't faint. Don't weary in this well-doing. There is a harvest coming for those who stand and believe. Everybody who remains faithful wins.
Yes, hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You got a dream in God? I pray in Jesus' name you dream it bigger. Because don't let the dream thieves come and steal it. Demonic powers come steal your dream in God, because you didn't imagine that for yourself. God, the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of the Son on the inside of you begin to cry out, Abba, Father, and create within you this desire that goes far beyond anything that anyone would ever predict before you, for you, anything that is evidenced around you. God's put a dream on the inside of you that He shapes, that He molds, and then He takes you and begins to prepare you to be able to stand up in it without doing yourself damage, and especially the name of Jesus, any damage. He matures us. Hallelujah. The bigger the work, come on now. Come on. The bigger the work, come on. The bigger the prize. Come on, people. Come on. I've got a prize. I've got a prize that I'm after. There's this prize that I want. I want to be presented before His presence with exceeding joy. I don't want to stand in the shadows. Hallelujah. I want to be right up front. I made up my mind long ago that I would be in the center of every one of God's outpourings. Whew. I mean, I've been here before. I know, I understand this. Fortunately, I have been here. God in His grace has made me aware of the day of my visitation and our visitation. And I believe if we just set our hearts there, if we say, Father, I'm going to be right in the center of every one of your movings, every one of your outpourings. I'm going to be ready to go with you. I'm not going to get stuck in a form of expression. I'm not going to get stuck in something that you did in order to get our attention. I'm going to run after you in every dimension of the things. I'm going to follow after you. And that's what I mean when run after. It's not this concept of trying to run God down. It's running after Him as I'm following Him to do His will, to do the will of the Father. Hallelujah. You're going to do that too. Yeah. Amen. Because we're going to provoke you. And we're going to point out to you if there's anything that we think that is in the way. If God, the Holy Ghost, has stirred us up to believe that there's something that's standing in your way, then we're going to tell you. Whether you like it or not, we're going to pray you come back. If you don't, we're going to commit you to the Lord Jesus Christ and to His keeping. Amen. We're not going to talk bad about you. We're not going to feel bad about you. We're going to love you and believe that God will use you in every possible way that you will allow Him. Because, I mean, you look at what Father's trying to talk us into being. He's trying to talk us into being something and doing something that is unimaginable. The utterances of God are incomprehensible. He utters His voice and the snow falls. And it's reserved for both His blessings and His judgment, the hail, the rain, all the dimensions of His creative work. Look at the works of His hands. Look at you. Go look at yourself in the mirror and start going, ah, look how fearful and wonderful I am made. Quit letting Satan tell you how whatever. All the shame and the condemnation and the fear. That's what Satan does. It happened right there in the garden. Man was walking around in the glory and the beauty and the splendor of relationship with the Father. He listened to the lies of Satan and immediately came under the shroud of his fear and of his shame and of his condemnation, his torment, and he had to run and hide from God. And praise the name of Jesus, who's brought us right back into this realm of divine glory. Somebody said He took us all the way back to Adam. No, He didn't. Took us all the way to Jesus. Amen. Took us all the way. I don't go to back to Adam. No. You can't ever go back. Adam, man can never go back to Adam. Adam was in an innocence without the knowledge of good and evil. Man, the redeemed man, possesses the knowledge of good and evil, and now only the Holy Ghost can master it. And so we allow Him to live and reign and rule our lives so that we may understand how to walk in this knowledge far beyond us. Hallelujah. He took us all the way to Jesus. Jesus took us all the way to the Father. Come on, man.
Come on.
The Holy Ghost took us all the way to Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Jesus took us all the way to the Father. You can be seated. I want every one of you to say this. Say this with me. And I'll just tell you where it is in case you don't know it. Colossians chapter 3 and verse 3 says, yes. I no longer live. Say, I no longer live.
I no longer live.
My life is hid.
My life is hid.
Let me give it to you a little bit more radically. Say, I am dead with Christ.
I no longer live.
My life is hid with God in Christ. Well, some of you are still looking at me kind of strangely, so I want you to look. I want you to turn. I want to know that you know where I just read, so that you're not going to be forgetful hearers. I'm not going to let you be forgetful hearers. So long as I'm in this tabernacle, I'm going to be like Peter. I'm going to stir you up and put you in remembrance of these things. See, there's, you know, Peter said concerning the fact that he was actually in the holy mountain. Oh, I could say the holy mountain. Anywhere God is, it's holy. We in the holy church here today. Anywhere God is, it's holy. It's holy by virtue of the fact that he's there. See, we're in the mountain. We heard that audible voice. We heard the excellency of the glory of the Father when he said, "This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased. Hear ye him." Now listen to this. That's pretty amazing event. Mount Transfiguration. But he said, we have a more certain word of prophecy. Uh-oh. Now everybody's dead in their tracks, okay? All this stuff that they've been talking about, thinking about. I've heard actually people say, you know, I've heard young people say, you know, there's been so much talking about the word and preaching the word, but very little evidence. So we just figured that the word would, if you just studied the word and read the word and believed the word in that respect, that ultimately the life of Jesus would be manifested in your life. They've been so deceived. I've had people actually tell me that. Listen, the Word of God is very important for you. And you want to read it and devour it and live it and do it. He says, but we have a more certain word of prophecy, whereunto you take heed, whereunto you do well if you take heed, as unto a light shining in a dark place. We're in a dark place. We're in a place where there is no ability to see except for by the word of God. If you want to see and you want to understand Father's will for your life, if you want to see and understand what the Holy Spirit is going to lead you to do and purpose you to do, if you want to understand how to think properly, if you want to understand how to walk in the mind of Christ, walking in the mind of Christ is no problem. It's walking in the word of God. Walking in the mind of the Spirit, having that spiritual understanding, no problem. Walking in the word of God. I want you to look with me quickly here at this, and I want you to believe it. I want you to say it over yourself until it's a living reality in you. Say, I'm dead. Verse 3, look at it. Say, I'm dead. All we did was just take it from this, you know, from second person, and we just made it first person for you. Because it's time that every word of God in the Bible, every scripture pertains to you. Jesus said, behold, I come in the volume of the book. It's all about me. It's all written about me. And now we don't have a different ministry nor a different life. We've got the one that Christ Jesus has. He gave us his life. I am dead. Say, I'm dead. I just pray in the name of Jesus that you'll grab a hold of this and it will be a living reality to you. Get up in the morning and say, I'm dead. And my life is hid with God in Christ. It's no longer take my will and make it thine. It shall be no longer mine. I mean, that is no problem anymore. When you ultimately give yourself over to say, look, I live to do the will of the Father. I'm not going to be one of those who say, Lord, Lord, and I never did the will of the Father. I'm not going to be one of these who chase after this thing, that thing, and the other thing, and I never did the will of the Father. I continue to walk in my own way. He says, depart from me, you workers of iniquity. I never knew you. I'm going to do the will of the Father. To do the will of the Father is just simply a resignation. So I'm not doing my own will anymore. I'm here for you. And sometimes we find ourselves in moments of uncertainty, and we just, all we got to do is cry out to God and say, Father, you know, all I want to do is your will. All I want to do is walk in your way. All I want to do is fulfill those things that you purpose for my life. I want nothing else but you, and I commit myself to your ability and your power to bring that to pass through me. Just begin to talk to him like that. Don't sit there and talk to yourself about it and wonder why and wonder how and wonder when. Talk to the Father about it. He's both willing and able to do all these things. Amen. Amen. Say, I'm dead.
I'm dead.
And my life is hid.
Woo.
With God in Christ. With God in
Christ.
Which means you can't see me. Which, go ahead, say it. Which means you can't see me.
You can't see me anymore.
I can't see me anymore.
Because I refuse to see me anymore.
If you're willing to see you, I guarantee you that's all you'll see, and that's all you'll be, and that's all you'll have. And then now you're beginning to understand what it means to deny yourself, to no longer know yourself after the flesh, but after the Spirit, to deny yourself, to say, look, it's no longer me that lives. It's Father that lives. It's Christ Jesus that lives. I'm not come to do my own will, but to do His will, to do the will of the Father who sent me. Father wants to hear it. That's why you and I were born again, born from above, made alive in Christ Jesus. And it's just about time we start having that personal relationship with Him instead of living out some religious ritual. Hello.
Amen.
Trying to get out of all of our uncertainty and all of our problems and all of our failures and all of our doctrinal ideas that keep us in bondage. Listen to me. I believe in He that the Son sets free is free indeed. I believe in complete glorious liberty, the glorious liberty of the sons of God. Hallelujah. I believe I've been bought with a price. I'm not my own. Hallelujah. We thus judge if one died for all, then all are dead. We should henceforth no longer live unto ourselves. I'm the temple of the living God. I'm baptized in the glory cloud of heaven. The fire of God's in me and on me. Hallelujah. I mean, I sunk to the bottom and breathing. I'm telling you right now. But somebody said, what is baptized? I said, in it and stay in there. Hallelujah. No sprinkle, no dip, no dunk. No forward, no backward, jump in, head first, sink to the bottom and breathe.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Hallelujah. Like a pickle. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on, baby, just go ahead and grab a hold of all that He's done for you. Look what all He did to make us everything He is. He who knew no sin became the sin offering, that we may be made the righteousness of God in Him. Hallelujah. A righteousness which cannot come through the human efforts or human ability, a righteousness that comes by the mighty working of the Holy Ghost in our life. See, Paul said in Galatians 3:21, he said, if there had been a law that could have imparted life, then righteousness would have been by the law. But all the law could conclude and all the law could testify is that men were absent of the life of God. But oh, bataye, epotane, eshe protani, kesteya. Jesus came and said, I am the life. Hallelujah. Come eat my flesh, drink my blood, come dwell in me. He that dwells in me has this kind of life. See, we want to make eternal life something that is like a, you know, it's a phrase and a concept that means something different to everyone, as it seems. But eternal life literally is the life of God. It's the life of the Spirit. It's the life that men lost when they left the presence of the Lord and stepped into the realms of darkness. Hallelujah. Whew. So I just want to take a moment just to thank all of you who understand and what we're doing in missions. I mean, we believe there's 3 billion people right now on the face of the earth, a little more than 3 billion people in nations like Nepal, Sikkim, Bhutan, Kashmir, the list goes on, Tajikistan, that have never heard the gospel one time. And we know that the only way that this, we believe that the only way that this is going to be accomplished through our lives is that we see sustainable business structures that are created in partnerships with missions to make that happen. And so somebody says, what are you doing? I said, well, I didn't start doing this 2 years ago, 3 years ago. I started doing this 17 years ago. I started dreaming about it almost 30 years ago. To begin to see orphans taken from nations like Afghanistan. And boy, I tell you right now, when the United States of America invaded Afghanistan, I knew people who actually sat on the transitionary government, the provisional transitional governmental board of Afghanistan. And two of them were Christians from Egypt. And I said, oh, if I had $100 million, I could go in, I could give the government $50 million, and with $50 million, I could take all the orphans. With the other $50 million, I could take all the orphans. I'd have protection by the government. I'd have protection by all the various different, you know, ruling entities there, but bigger, I'd have protection by the Holy Ghost, okay? you know, I'd have permission. I'd take all the orphans. You know how many orphans could have been gotten in Afghanistan at the beginning of that war, the beginning of that invasion, off on the tail end of the treachery of the Taliban and the beginning of the U.S. bombing? Literally, there were hundreds of thousands of children to be had. No one did it. No one in the church did it. No one's ready to do that. Why? Because God's not ready? Nonsense. That's nonsense. We're not ready. We don't have plans. We don't have strategy. We don't implement vision that God gives us. And sometimes what happens is some of the visions that God gives, I'm going to tell you right now, people think you can start a business and eat the fruit of it in the second year. It's nonsense. The Lord himself said, you plant a vineyard, you can't uncircumcise until the third and fourth year. You know, any business doesn't have profitability till the third and fourth year. And then, of course, you know, in this situation where we up against the principalities and powers of darkness and the things that Satan believes he owns all the riches. Listen to what he said, Jesus. He believes he can fight us on every point. Fight you physically. He fights you spiritually. He'll fight you financially. It's just you got to learn how to kick him in the teeth right. Shut his mouth. Huh? Kick somebody in the teeth right properly and they won't say nothing else. It's true. It's true. And so the bottom line of it is, you know, 17 years ago we began to do this. And then when I was coming back from Yanji, China, and I was trying my best to get to North Korea. I was supposed to go into North Korea. The Lord prevented it. I look back on it now because I'm just like, I'm just gun-ho. I'm going. If somebody says I can get in and opens the door, I'm not going to pray about it. I'm running to that door. And Father has to prevent the madness of my consecration to him. And so I stood there looking, standing on the banks of the Yangtze River, looking over at the North Korean soldiers, waving at a few, being able to see the power of God touch at least one North Korean man that came across the border, just standing there going, Lord, what is it going to take? What is it going to take to see North Korea shaken by the power of God? See, I don't see North Korea like people see North Korea because they listen to CNN. Most people don't have it enough spiritual maturity to watch CNN, and especially Fox, because they're probably worse. Because they're more in agreement with whatever it is you think you believe. And of course, I pray in Jesus' name, you don't believe anything but the Word of God.
That's right. Praise God.
But North Korea is the people of the Holy Ghost. Korea is the people of the Holy Ghost. You hear me?
Yes.
That's the great outpouring of the Holy Ghost. Yanji, you can still see the great revival church of 1880. They never tore it down. The communists never tore it down. It had such a legacy, such a history, such a great outpouring, God would not allow. It sits on the highest hill in northern China next to the greatest military base of the Communist People's Republic of China, a church steeple so high you can see it from miles and miles around. Hey, it's a symbol. What is the symbol of? It's a symbol of the great revival of the Holy Ghost. 1880, swept Korea, 1880. 1890, a great outpouring of God that then moved up into China. By 1907, China was on fire. Northern China was on fire with the glory of God. Man, that stuff excites me. Whew. I'm ready to get on an airplane right now. It's going to happen again. North Korea, all of Korea will burn with the glory of heaven once again. It will. It will. Father is bigger than all the stuff that's going down in the political structures of men. So I said, I was there, and I'm just like, oh God, what is it going to take? What do you want me to do? How am I going to do this thing? I administered that week with, you know, people. I mean, there's this one group, this one couple that just so stands out to me. I had baptized a medical doctor with, all we had was bottles of water. He gave his life to Jesus in a secret meeting. And I took bottles of water. We baptized him. One of the most beautiful baptismal services I've been in. Just kept dumping water on until he was drenched. Soaked. And he got into a secret meeting. He came with his couple, very intelligent men and women. They had a young daughter, she was about 5 years old, 6 years old, something like that. And then had a little baby boy, he's barely walking. Their whole life before them, either one of them, they could have been anything they wanted to be. You name it, they could have been it. You could just see that they had that look, being very intelligent people. And they were on their way in the underground pipeline into North Korea. No way back. Going in. And so I was there for a week to this minister. Everybody was going to North Korea. And then I'm like left. I'm left out waving goodbye, you know, basically. To the folks, Father, what's it going to take? What's it going to take? You know, I mean, you know, every time I go to these different places, I'm like, you know, it's like many times early on, as the Lord said, go look and see. I just go look and see. And then the Lord sent me back, of course, to Nepal. What God did with us through in Nepal, you know, it's just a token of what He's going to do. He'll do for anyone. I mean, I had people, and T.L. Osborne was talking about wanting to go. Tim Hall had already bought his ticket. Others wanted to go with me to the crusade we did in 2008. Tim Hall, you can ask him about it to this day, ask him. He woke up that morning, already had his ticket bought. Woke up that morning totally paralyzed. He could not get out of bed. He was paralyzed for 2 days. He could not get out of bed. Could not move. Why? Because the Lord wanted to say, no. I'm going to show you. I'm going to take people who are nobodies, and I'm going to say hello to a nation. Look, this is what God will do. We want to make all these different things. We make all these levels in the anointing. It's all nonsense. Are you in Jesus? There's no level there, man. It's whether or not you're going to agree with them. That's it. If you want to say agreement is a level, how much word do you believe? Oh, that's level one. You believe two words. Okay. You know, how much word do you believe? Oh, you believe two chapters. Oh, that's level two. Whatever. I mean, come on. Father's eyes go to and fro throughout the earth, seeking someone whom He may show Himself mighty on their behalf. And He's not picky. When I first went, Brother Yun, the heavenly man, and Brother Shi, who was over Brother Yun, and who now gets to go back into China, when they first put me on the board of Back to Jerusalem in 2000, 2001, and they sent me to Nanyang, they said, listen, we want you to go and minister. Because it was the first declaration of 100,000 young people going to go give their life on the mission field. And I said in my spirit, they don't need to go give their life. They don't need to go die. They need to go live. I'm going to go, Father, use me and go speak faith into them that they live through mighty signs and wonders. They can't die. They'd be like John, you know? I mean, come on, go die. There's so few missionaries as it is. We can't afford to lose any that we got. You got to go talk to them about living. You know, and Ann went with me that trip. We went up to the heavenly people, which were the great-great-grandfather. Whew. The great-great-grandfather was involved in the great heavenly, what was called the revival, the people's, the moving of the Holy Ghost, or the people of the Holy Ghost. They came, also called themselves the heavenly people. The grandfather was drugged through the streets until he died. He was a medical doctor and a preacher, and they drugged him through the streets until he died during the Cultural Revolution. There's a long legacy in history. They are brazen, man. They go right onto the campuses, in the main campus in one of the big provinces of China and preaches the gospel. They don't care. Arrest me. They don't care. It's just who they are. And at any rate, there was how many? I don't remember how many. I think it was about 100 or so in their little school. Every one of them training to go into Saudi Arabia, to go to Mecca and die for Jesus, to go, hallelujah. At that time, what was that? That was like 2004 or 2005. We were a lot in China at that time. And I think it was 2004. I'm like, Lord, how do we help these people? They have no means of provision for themselves. How can we help them? And I understand. Listen, don't tell me about living by faith. Come on. I was born in it. My dad is a preacher. I learned about what it means to live by faith, and I understand that there should be some strategy involved in it as well. Believe me, okay? And so we began to really say, oh God, what can we do? By 2012, when I was coming back from ENG, I'm on the airplane, and the Lord said, take the property in Oregon, dedicate it to the Mission Training Center. And so that's what we did. We said, okay, we're going to take this particular piece of property. A dear friend of mine and I bought the property some time ago, a long time ago. And we were just, once again, what we were doing was we were buying property and selling it and working towards ultimately getting to a place where we could fund our own crusades. didn't have to take a dollar from anyone, where we could fund the orphanages. And the ministry vision the Lord gave us for orphanages and for church planting, all within the network of that which already exists, touched by the fire of God. Are you with me? Because we walked in Nepal. There was, similar to God already existed, Methodist Church already existed, Presbyterian Church already existed. But what happened in 2006, they got so touched with the fire of God, signs and wonders and miracles, and the outpouring of the Holy Ghost upon their life, they were changed. And that resulted in us having a network of over 1,000 orphanages in the one single nation. Why go build something new when it's already there? What we want to do is we'll make it better, because what they eat on Christmas, they eat on, you know, Passover, they eat on, which most people call Bunny Day, but it's really Resurrection Sunday. And I'm never going to say Easter, because I'm not going to take her name up into my lips. Maybe you don't even understand that. I'm just going to bypass it right on by it. But nonetheless, are you listening to me?
Yes.
Okay. Resurrection Sunday. And then sometimes American church gives on Thanksgiving. And then it's pretty tough from there on in. And then they're not properly educated. So by the time they're 18 years old, they're on the streets. They could have been raised to be the next leaders of the nation. They could have been raised to be the next leaders, both politically and spiritually, of the nation and in business.
Yep.
And then I ran into a person, you know, who was dead by the time I come to know who they were, who put together a model that 300 of the main 300 leaders in the nation of Nepal came out of his orphanage, and he did it just like I was feeling that this is what needs to be done. He did it just, it was a couple of minor changes. And I said, okay, Father, how can we do this? How can I do this? And it's just brooding in me and building in me. 2012, I said, okay, Lord, this is what we're going to do. You breathe on it. Prevent the madness of the prophet. We're going to build sustainability through agricultural businesses, because then it functions properly. Because then we can ultimately train and oversee food supply to the orphanage, food supply to the local churches. And then as it grows and matures with the blessing of God, I'm going to tell you right now, he's the one who controls the rain and the ground. It ain't stock market. Devil ain't in it. Devil can't create rain. Amen. He can't make things grow. God alone does. Hallelujah. So I'm in partnership with the best kind of business you can think of. Hallelujah. And so, you know, then the vision was to go ahead, take the orphan, get these programs set up within the framework of the orphanages. Not only are they receiving the benefit of the food, but they're receiving skills now being developed. Then when they're 18 years old, we promote them. We bring them here to the United States of America. They go through a three-year program. And we just are so blessed that everyone can see and understand that this is what we're doing. We are creating business. Our business has already been created. It's been going. It's had its ups and downs. I mean, there are times where, I mean, we got hit by the storm of 2008, 2009, lost close to $14 million. Somebody said, how do you ever recover from that? It's Papa's. He has it all. $14 million for him is the same as $14 trillion. To you and me, it's like, how do you recommend? What is it? So we didn't, you know, we just start over. We just start from the beginning. We start from the beginning, and we're going to stop. And we're not stopping starting from the beginning. But we just appreciate every one of you can see and understand and participate with the vision. Because some people don't like my statement here, but nonetheless, you have to listen to it anyways. I'm building something that lasts 200 years. The Roman Catholic Church did a very good job of it. Do you know the single largest holder of all agricultural real estate and all agricultural products is today in the United States of America? Take a wild guess.
Mormon.
That's correct. Mormon Church. The Mormon Church. They live the dream, the biblical dream of God's people. Why? Strategy. Commitment. Long-term goals and visions. Huh? You listening to me?
Yes.
They are so unified in their heresy, while we so scattered and chopped up into little divisional kingdoms, and we got the truth. Yep. God help us. Yep. Okay, and we're just, you know what? I just believe that Father will do a work to bring that to an end. There's somebody who's going to just be sober and think sensibly and run with the power of God and the anointing. I understand. I've been through the whole commission. If you get too educated, you can't have the anointing. I remember that. If you get too rich, you can't have the anointing. That's the way we used to tell it. If you were going to be a part of the Holy Ghost movement, you had to be stupid and poor. I understand this. I come from Pentecost. My great-grandfather chased ambulances to... because he was baptized in the Holy Ghost and he wanted to have first shot at him before the doctors got to them. I kid you not. Hallelujah. We have deep roots in Pentecost. Hallelujah. Yeah. But that's just simply not the case. I'm going to minister to you this morning about the unsearchable riches of Christ. Praise God. I want to talk to you about the unsearchable riches of Christ. I want to talk to you about the one who was rich and became poor for our sake, that through his poverty we might be made rich. I want to talk to you about being blessed with all spiritual blessings in a heavenly realm. Be one in the earthly, no, heavenly. But heavenly is higher than the earthly. And when you got in heavenly, you got everywhere. Hallelujah. 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 I want to just begin to just help you understand what Father has made available to you and me. If we're just willing to believe, if we'll take the things of the kingdom, the things, the spiritual riches, the spiritual quality of life, it will allow the Holy Ghost to train us to think right. See, thinking isn't about how many brain cells you have. Being smart isn't about how many brain cells you have. It's about the state of your spirit. God wants to make your spirit correct and right. You'll remember everything. It's photographic memory. You're not disturbed or twisted or convoluted in your spirit. Come on now. Yes. Listen to me. Yes. I'm telling you right now. God calm you down. You won't, listen, if you realized it, everything you ever experienced, everything you ever learned, you know, you just can't recall it. And I'm not going to get in that because that could go off into philosophy. I'm just telling you right now. Let's just listen to me. Just listen to me. Father has given to us the privilege of stepping over into coming to know Him, to go after the kingdom of God and His righteousness. And everything is cured there. Everything is healed there. All provision is established in our life. The Word of God trains us to think right, to behave right, to have the right attitudes, to know how to throw down wrong emotions, to know how to throw down wrong attitudes, to know how to get out of our lives the fear and the turmoil and the discouragement and the depression and the upset that just messes us up. We can't think properly. Yep. He teaches us how to relax. You do your best when you relax. You remember the most when you relax. You get all tense. You get all afraid. There's all these various different repercussions of fear. We've received the Spirit of the Son. We are not under the bondage of fear anymore. We received the Spirit of the Son. We got the Spirit of Jesus Christ. He that confesses that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, God dwells in him and he dwells in God. 1 John 4:15. What a powerful reality to know that Jesus Christ is Lord. You cannot know. Anyone can say He is Lord, but you can't know that He is Lord without a revelation from God the Holy Ghost. And when you respond to that and you say, I want the full impacts of it, and you don't just stop along and camp out with the nursery school. Hello? Getting trapped by criticism and strife and division and envy and having all the things that ultimately would entangle you in the realms of human provision, but you set your affections on things above where Christ is seated at the right hand of the Father. Listen, everything belonging to the power of God comes from the right hand of the Father. Colossians chapter 3, verse 1 through 3. Right there at the right hand of God, what God did when He raised Jesus from the dead and set Him at His own right hand in the heavenly places, He gave to us exceeding greatness of His power. He gave to us the privilege of having an understanding to where we could know who we are in Him and what His inheritance is in us, which is a radical concept. I can understand How that I get an inheritance in him, being made heirs with God. I can kind of understand that. The more you understand it, the more you're going to use it. Because the word will produce faith, and faith will produce a doing. And I'm telling you right now, when you begin to move as an heir of God, you're not stuck no more. Hallelujah. When you're being taught by the Holy Ghost, you're not stuck anymore. Hallelujah. You can remember stuff for the first time in your life. Smith Wigglesworth stepped into the realm of faith. I love talking about him because of the things that happened in his life. As an old guy, it's hard to learn new things. As an old guy, he did not know how to learn. He didn't know how to write his name. His wife taught him how to write his name. Think about this. He never read anything. He reads the Bible, memorizes the whole thing. That is, from a natural point of view, just on the level of impossibility. Because he's in his 50s. He's never trained his mind, his thinking realm to work like that. Just shows you what God the Holy Ghost would do when you let the Holy Spirit be your teacher. Woo, he's the best teacher. My goodness gracious, he'll give you some memory skills you can't even imagine. He'll bring all things to your remembrance. Amen. You just got to learn how to walk over in this realm. See, the frustration realm, the fearful realm. God would bring to us a place of great confidence and boldness if we'll just begin to be trained by his word. The living word came to show us and give us the power to ultimately be trained in and fully live out the word. And that's where the power is, and the riches, and the glory, and the honor, and the value. When we say, Lord Jesus, be glorified in my life, we're saying, Lord, be valued in my life. Come to be honored in my life. The only way he's going to do that is through mighty signs and wonders. When our voice begins to sound like the utterance of the Almighty, when our speech becomes filled with his doctrines and with his wisdom, that changes the hearts of men, that make those who would hear for the first time and those who would hear for the long time so full of the thirst from heaven because we're so salty. Amen. The light would shine so bright, come on, that the darkness that has been hampering them and hindering them and stopping them along the way. Come on. Father wants us out of the realm of self-identity and into the realm of Christ Jesus. He died for us at Calvary's cross, went down into hell, ascended up, rose from the dead, rather, and ascended up on high so that we would no longer live unto ourselves. For ourselves, with our own identity. We make it all the things that it's not supposed to be. We turn it into religion rather than a relationship and a life that we walk out and that we live. We make it so difficult because we've compromised who we are and what we think about ourselves. Man, when you become 100% his and you recognize that Jesus Christ is the Son, anybody who confesses that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. Jesus said, they that confess me before men, I will confess before my Father which is in heaven. For with the heart man believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made known unto salvation. Where is this confession? It's this word of God which is near unto you, in your heart and in your mouth. Hallelujah. For with the believing, and what Father does is he comes by the Holy Ghost. Somebody says, help, oh God, I believe, help my unbelief. That's what the Holy Ghost is here for. Yes. He's fill you here. Well, he's going to fill you with faith. I mean, I love how God moves and begins to through us to show us how that we got to depend upon him. We don't know a thing we're saying or a thing we're doing, but if we'll depend upon him, he'll bring forth the issues of life from the heart. Hallelujah. They get us this hysterically happy. Sometimes they say they've coined a disease state for me now. You know, where I'm laughing hysterically happy and crying at the same time, and I've got some kind of a disease. I'll tell you right now, I got the cure. Hallelujah. You got the disease. I got the cure. Hallelujah. It's the cure that's doing these things. It's showing us how easy it is to be filled with the Spirit of the Lord. It fills us with faith. We just say, oh, God, fill me with faith. Huh? We don't say, oh, I wish I had faith. That's doubt and unbelief. We say, thank you, Father, for filling me with faith. I need it right now. Hallelujah. And then you begin to walk out and find, oh, God, fill me with wisdom. What does he do? Does he just give in proportion? Does he just give with restraint? Say, well, I don't know if you're ready for it. He gives liberally to who? Those who are mature and are ready for it. Anyone who asks. The Lord says, When you get matured enough and you come to the highest rank of all and you now stand among the mighty, then you can ask, and these works which I do shall you do in greater works. He doesn't say that. He said, anyone who believes, anybody who believes, the believing, the man believes with his heart. If you don't doubt in your heart, you'll say to the mountain, to speak it out and declare those things which God has said in His Word. Why? Because you've been willing to be fastened by the Word of God, shaped by the Word of God, to process by the Word of God, to let the Word of God be the light unto your feet, a lamp unto your feet, and light unto your path. So the Word of God tells you where every step is placed. I pray today that you get yourself a heavenly vision and you understand how to do something every day in it. I try to challenge people all the time. Oh, give me a 30-year plan. People are like, I just want to serve the Lord. Yeah, but you know what? With that, you're going to do nothing. That's good-hearted. Bless your darling heart. You just want to serve the Lord. But you're not going to do nothing. Huh? You listen to me. You might labor all your life doing work and, you know, 10, 12 hours a day for food and for raiment. But kingdom of God, you're not going to do anything. Somebody says, well, I really don't know what to do. Get down on your face before the Lord and begin to cry out to God. If need be, fast and pray. But I even got a better way. Start consuming the Word. Start living the Word. You'll get yourself a vision bigger than you can. It'll scare you. The vision you'll get will scare you to death. The first thing you're going to be challenged with in your vision is that it's bigger than you. It's impossible for you to ever do it. First thing's going to come with a vision that comes from heaven is second thing's going to come to discouragement. Because it's going to be you're going to say, how can you? Because you can't think it out. You can't plan it out. It's just too big. How are we going to reach more than 3 billion people? Somebody said, look at it. How can we reach more than 3 billion people? Look at all the 50 people in this church. Look at it. What are you talking about? Listen, that's exactly right. That's demonic. Because this is what this is how it's going to go down. The same way that we've faithfully been here for 34 years and watched thousands of people go through the building. Have been privileged by the Lord to touch thousands of lives. I guarantee you, Lord, I was thinking about the other day. In fact, I believe I was even thinking about it this morning. How if one person leaves and moves out of the building, somebody else immediately move in. Amen. It's like there's this number thing. The Lord won't allow it to be any less than a specific number. And then it's just like, it's just his business. It doesn't even matter to me. What matters to me is ultimately finding myself doing everything that Jesus described for me to do. And what all happens as the situations and the fiery trials try you and the hand of God shapes you as you begin to be examined. What are you seeking, the honor and the praise which come from men? Or you just want that which comes from the Lord? People are going to talk. People are going to talk if you're successful, and they're going to talk if you're a failure, and they're going to talk just as negative. It don't matter what, forget about that. Everybody's going to have their opinions, they're going to have their twist, they're going to have their spin, they're going to have their false accusations, they're going to have their true accusations. Forget about it. Just go after the heavenly vision. Quit saying, what about him? And follow me, Jesus said. Man, it's peril. What about him? Peter. What about John? Forget about John. You can follow me. Hallelujah. We want you to get a heavenly vision. Come. We want you to live big for Jesus. Amen. We want you to understand that you can come follow us as we follow him. Yes. 1,700 years ago, roughly, a group called the Roman Catholic Church got a vision. And actually, they own more property than any entity in the world. They have more wealth, more riches. They have their own nation. They have their own money. Vatican money. Somebody got a vision. Somebody got a long-term vision. Imagine what would happen when people full of the Holy Ghost get a vision. Hallelujah. I got a vision. I got a vision for 3 billion people. Somebody said, how are you going to do it? I'm going to follow the heavenly vision. I'm going to do it the way the Lord describes it. I'm going to have a plan. Hallelujah. And we're going to let God bless it. And everybody who participates with it is going to get blessed too. Look at how Father had a plan with Abraham. He's got one person and he says, I'm going to raise up a family that will begin to establish a culture of the kingdom in the earth. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father, for the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Whew. Praise His holy and wonderful name. The Word of God's right here. The Word of God is the means by which Christ Jesus, the living Word, is the means by which God brought every miracle, every dimension of redemption, every dimension of heaven and the blessings of God to man. Both before He came and was manifested 2,000 years ago in the flesh, because it's been all about Him. When Abel offered a sacrifice, it was that sacrifice represented Jesus. When Moses offered, when Abraham offered a sacrifice, represented Jesus. Are you listening to me? Jesus, Abraham said, I saw His day. Hallelujah. When Job stood in righteousness and uprightness as a perfect man before God. Why? Because he said, I know my Redeemer lives and she'll stand upon the earth in the last day. Hallelujah. Yeah. Listen to the faith in Jesus. Come on. Hallelujah. Moses saw him. He said, there's a prophet coming like me. My goodness, you're going to listen to him. If you don't, Father's not going to have any mercy. Basically, that's what was said. He saw him. Jesus is there, standing big in the Old Testament, and he's the central focus of everything. His name has been exalted above every name. You know, when I was in Japan recently, and I just praise God for the people from Japan watching, and it's a free republic. It's a free republic that lives under fear and intimidation from hell. One of the most unreached people groups on the planet. It is just, it's so tragic what's going on there. But I was crying out to the Lord. I said, Father, you look very small here. This is big in my heart. I'm telling you, it's things that are big in my heart. And I'm just telling you how the Lord just connect the dots. I mean, the Lord is putting us right into the economy of Japan, isn't He? Right into the economy of Japan. Not only into the spiritual dimension of Japan, right into the economy of Japan. It's been going on for over a year, about a year and a half now. Something like that. Whew. It's true. We just start walking out with God. He just opens the doors. Or He says, no, go sit down for a while. I want to just enjoy my presence. Huh? And then we just enjoy His presence, then we got to run with it, and we get up, and all of a sudden doors start opening right, left, and center. Come on. It's just, He'll move on our behalf. And I was there on one of the tallest buildings in Tokyo, the largest city in the world, 27 million people. And I said, Lord, You look very small here. So I'm unchurched, biggest churches are 30 people. 30. I mean, we went and ministered in Ann and I ministered in four of the major cities of Japan recently. And the big meetings, I mean, when Benny Hinn, or you just try to take some big name and take them there, it's not going to be a lot of people. It's just an unreached people group. It's under the terror of demon power. So, Father, You look very small here. What's going on? Why? Why? Is there no man on earth that can represent You here in this nation and have any impact upon this nation? It's free. We can get down on the street corner and preach right now. I went out of a meeting one night. Where were we? We were in Osaka. We're in Osaka. And when I get in third world nations, I mean, I just like get people's names. I mean, I just know where they're from. I mean, it's just, I have a flow there that I just love. But bottom line of it, and I don't understand the dynamics. So that's Father's business, and not, you know, we're just blessed to be able to participate. I walk out on the street, man, and I mean, I just, the power of God was so on me, I just started ministering to people. Then some of the elders from the larger church in Osaka came to me and said, oh, you can't do this. You can't minister on the street like this. I said, well, why not? He said, oh, you go to jail. I said, you're kidding me. Is this a law? No, oh, it's an unwritten law. It isn't a what? So I discovered that they under the bondage of a terror from hell. They're under a lie. There's no written lie. This is a free republic. Nobody can come and arrest me for preaching the gospel. Oh, yeah, they can, because people will say that you're disturbing the peace. No, I'm not disturbing the peace. I'm bringing peace. I'm disturbing unpeace. Amen. But at any rate, anyway, I'm standing there on the 47th floor, and I'm talking to the Lord like this, and I wasn't complaining. I was in anguish. God, why? Why? And, you know, I'm like going, and I said, Lord, raise up men, raise up women. Mission. See, we had an opportunity as the United States of America at the end of the World War II to flood the place with missions. Church of America didn't respond. MacArthur said, send me your missionaries. They were now at the crossroads. Are they going to stop the imperial worship that had been going on for millennials? Or are they going to allow it to go on? They allowed it to continue, the stronghold continue. It was all in our hands. It's in the church's hands. It was in our hands. It's like people talking about, oh, we don't want ISIS to come. Bring them. Bring them. Bring all the nations, unreached people and groups of the world. Let them come in. And let there come a great outpouring of the Holy Ghost. Let all the nations of the earth find refuge here in a place where the power of God is flowing so much that even the White House bows its knee. It's just that we abdicated our power. We believe something else about ourselves. We turned aside every man to his own way. Every man rose up to his own tent when God called his army to find themselves assembled in array with his glory and his power. Oh, yeah, it's true. And because I know I don't participate. I know it. Therefore, I have a requirement to participate. Everybody else, you're going to have to find it out. And you've heard it. God wants to make it real to you. But you got to begin to participate with the Holy Ghost for it to become real. Somebody said, I'm just going to sit around here and wait for it to become real. No, you have to participate. You have to start being a doer of the word for the word to become living. Hallelujah. Otherwise, the word is dead and inactive. The word, the living word, Christ Jesus. You're going to have to do the word for the word to become living in you. Christ Jesus. It's a heavenly vision for a lost and dying world. I wrote Obama at the beginning of the week. I said, send me as many Syrian Christians as you can possibly muster. I'll stuff them in the closets. I'll put them in the living room. I'll build places for them to live. I got property. Come on, man. Hallelujah. I'll be the answer to every Syrian Christian prayer. I'll just put you in that situation and see what you'd be wanting us to do over here. Are you listening to me? Hey, amen. It's like I said on Wednesday night, give me 5 minutes with anybody from ISIS. Because the one on the inside of me is greater than the one on the inside of him. And it's time for a contest to begin. It's time for somebody to have enough understanding of God and of his love and his goodness to quit thinking like CNN, quit thinking like Fox, quit thinking like all the conspiracy theory hippies. Yep. Good. Are the governments contaminating our food? No. To be able to bring food to the marketplace and make a profit, you got to do it the way it's being done. You bring healthy food to the marketplace, and now all of a sudden, at the cash register, people want the bad food rather than the good food. Period. It's pretty much that simple. Believe me, I know lots of ranchers and farmers, and come on. We in this business. You listen to me. Are you listening to me? Come on, folks, listen to me. It's about time we quit believing whatever all the stories and lies, because we filter it. And then we mix it and we become an amalgamation of the word of man and the word of deception with the word of truth. And we're not going to make any headway there. We're going to have to consecrate ourselves, purify ourselves, set ourselves apart. Come over here, stand with Jesus, living by the word, walking in the word means living in the spirit, walking in the spirit, living in the spirit, walking in the spirit means living in the word, walking in the word, just being who God told us we are. Ha! When people say you can't be it, you just stand up and you just be that much more of what he said you are.
That's right.
5 o'clock in the morning in Asia, everybody prays in Asia. 200 million people in China pray at 5 o'clock in the morning. It was no wonder the Lord woke me up at 5 o'clock in the morning that next morning and said to me, all authority is given to me in heaven and earth. I'm telling you, and with that voice in my dream, earth stood out so strong. Earth. All authority is mine in earth. Matthew 28, 18. All the authority belongs to me. Father has set me far above all principalities and powers and might and dominion. I was in Nanyang, China. I had about over 70 of the foremost leaders of China, the House Church of China, in the meeting. I'm not saying this to brag. I'm telling you the condition, the situation that we're in. The people on the front row had just recently been released from prison. Some of the women's faces were still swollen from being beaten by policemen. I had some of the People's Republic of China's soldiers hanging in the windows in the back, listening. And the Spirit of the Lord came upon me, and I said, the church is greater in power than all government authorities. For the name of Jesus has been exalted above all principalities and powers. In every name that is named, all authorities, all governmental powers, all spiritual powers. We are, as the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, are the fullness of Him that filleth all things, being set by Him at His own right hand. It's about time people start believing it. Because I'll tell you right now, when you put your life in the hands of the Lord, nobody can touch you. I had the secret police chasing me when I left Nanyang. But the Lord preserved me and kept me. And He'll keep you. Right here in the United States of America, He'll keep you. It's about time that we begin to live out the Word. Not out of constraint. Or not because we have to. But because there's a bubble up inside. Because there's a jumping around on the inside. Listen, if you don't have a jumping around on the inside, just stay in the fellowship hall till the glory hits you that way. I'm going to tell you right, just stay loving Jesus. Just stay loving on Jesus. Don't be all stressed out. Don't be in a panic, because it has nothing to do with all your labors and all your efforts. Give me a break. It's God will put the motivation on the inside of you like the floodgates of heaven being opened up from your heart. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. Hallelujah. All authority is given to me in heaven and earth. Satan believes he rules, and he does rule in the realm of darkness. He's the prince of the power of the atmosphere, but has no effect on me and you, lest we give it effect. Lest all of a sudden we come under his rule. Lest all of a sudden we are subject to his rule. God made the church for the cure for all social and moral evils, not governmental powers, not all this other stuff. Not all this legislation. Somebody said, look what the Supreme Court did. I said, look at what the church already did. It's just a reflection of our abdication, of our authority. And the Lord spoke to me and just said very sternly and absolutely, I'm looking for someone to agree with me. I got up out of that bed and I said, Father, I agree with you. Show me how to start. I'm not going to walk in my imaginations of my mind for a heavenly vision. God, show me how to start. Show me where to begin. I consecrate my life upon the altar to live my life fully for you. Show me where to begin. Show me where to start. People, we pray that you don't allow Satan to paralyze you, that you don't have paralysis, the classic paralysis by analysis, trying to figure it out. Just start worshiping God. Start walking around the thing. Just start walking around the thing, following the priest, walking around the thing, following the covenant of God, walking around. All of a sudden, Father's going to put a shout on the inside of you. Wah! And something's going to happen. Woo! Something's going to happen. All of a sudden, every hindrance is going to fall and sink into the ground. It's going to sink into the ground. It sunk. I didn't believe the walls crumbled. The walls would have crumbled. It would have been harder to get over with crumbled walls than it would have been to scale a flat wall. Are you with me? It would have been a bigger mess to get over. It had been more fortified than ever before. You listen to me. Sunk. Poof, right down into the earth. Woo! Sink hole from heaven. Hallelujah. One moment there is a wall, next moment no wall. Like a curtain dropped. Hallelujah. It's the way it works. You know it. You know when you've been caught away in the glory. You know when you've been raptured in prayer. You've been raptured in praise. Where the Spirit of the Lord has had free course with you. And you stood up tall. And you understood exactly how you were supposed to go about it. What you were supposed to do. Come on, that's where it all happens. You don't think it through. You pray it through. You let God come show you. He wants to reveal to you. He wants to give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of Him so you can understand who you are and how big God made you when He raised Jesus up from the dead. We're going to have to stop following the leadership of CNN, spin doctors, Fox News. Because as long as you're doing that, you're in bondage. You're in prison. You have abdicated your authority. You have no more power to speak, for your heart is meditating upon other things. Doubts and unbelief, lies from hell. A lie will bring you into bondage as much as the truth will set you free. A lie will cause you to be damned as much as the truth will cause you to live eternally. They shall believe a lie and be damned. I'm not believing no lie. And the only protection for against believing a lie is walking, obeying the word of God and walking in His God, the Holy Ghost, humility. Because I know a lot of people, I've known a lot of people who've known the word of God, but they're arrogant. And so it never becomes a living reality in their life. It's all about head knowledge. But you get clothed with, and so the enemy can deceive them. But you get clothed with humility and walk in love, hallelujah. And you stand living by the word and speaking the word, hallelujah. You believe in your heart. Anybody can say stuff. Jesus talked about anyone who can say stuff in Matthew chapter 7. Many will say in that day, that he said, not everyone who says, Lord, Lord. And that's not a contradiction to what he said in 1 Corinthians when he said no one can say that Jesus is Lord, but in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, but by the Holy Ghost. No one can understand that he is, because that's what it means. No one can understand, really understand that he is the Lord, that he is Almighty God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. People, I'm going to say right now, anytime Jehovah's Witness tell you Jesus never says God, and then never says it, just say Lord. That's God. Understand that. I just want to stop for just a moment. Maybe Jehovah's Witness is watching me right now. The New Testament says well over 300 times that Jesus Christ is God, Almighty God. Write me. I'll send you the list of verses. I was talking to a Jehovah's Witness just the other day. He said, you're the first Christian to ever tell me that. You're the first Christian who knew that Jesus said he was God in the Bible. I said, well, all I can do is say I'm sorry. I've been doing a poor job, evidently, of training people. Huh? And the ministry company that I belong to, we've been doing a terrible job helping people understand how to speak the word. Because it's the word that sets free. It's the truth. It's the entrance of his word that brings light. It's the entrance of his word that brings life. The word was manifested that we might live. The living word who revealed the written word. Come on, people. I want you to get into the word. People start doing things, speaking things outside the word of God. It's just flaky. It just goes crazy. It's where familiar spirits step in. Oh, but what is the defense? What a great training ground. What a great protection. Hallelujah. Oh, the name of the Lord is like a high tower. This the very name of the Lord Jesus, like a high tower. The righteous run in and are saved. That's why I'm always just the name of Jesus. Just Jesus has given us all authority to go and preach the gospel, to go and declare in his name. These miracles shall follow them that believe. In my name, the greatest authority. To have a wisdom and understanding of his name, to confess, to proclaim, in other words, his name. Living in God, walking in God. 1 Corinthians chapter 12 says, it's by the Holy Ghost that we have, you and I sitting here right now, we have a revelation of who Jesus is. You know Christ Jesus is Almighty God. Holy Ghost gave you that. He wants to give you a whole lot more. And it's all going to be it's always going to form in the same way. It's going to go, on that understanding, that wisdom, that ability to function in him, going to form in the same way. It's going to come by the word. Holy Ghost is going to make it real. I believe in a great outpouring of the Holy Ghost that is greater than anything that has ever happened in the United States of America. That's why I want all the nations to come. Bring them. Buddhist, Islam, Hindus, whatever you are, hoo-hoos, whatever. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. I don't want to wipe you out. I want to set you free. Come on, people. Come on. Come. Why do we think the way we think? How is it that we've allowed such pollution of our lives with the things that belong to the prince of the power in the air and the realms of men? Come on. I know something greater than a gun for protection.
and I'm not going to compromise it by having one. I know something greater than the sword for preservation, and I'm not going to compromise it by having one. I know something better than raiment and clothes, and I'm not going to compromise the provision of it by looking to my own hand to supply. Listen, do you hear what I'm telling you? Come on, people, live big in God. Start believing what God says about you.
Hallelujah. Mandate yavate
asuto ya. I want you to hear this one thing. I want you to hear. The word's not far away from you. All that God has purposed you to do, Deuteronomy chapter 30, Moses is talking about, here's the greatness that God has for you. These are the great things. You got all these slaves sitting around looking at Moses.
And he's saying, this is all God has for you. He's going to make you a kingdom above all the kings of the earth. He's going to bless you above all the people of the earth. He's going to give you wealth and riches. You are treasured people to him. You are royal people. You are a holy nation. That's what he's saying to them. And he's saying, you can do this. They're like, how are we going to do this? How are we going to do this? And they're just looking at him like, you know, staring off in this space, looking at the birds. Oh, look at the bird. It's a beautiful bird. Well, the word of God is coming forth to them. He's saying, like, the word of God is how you're going to do it. It's right there. It's right there in your heart and in your mouth, that you may do it. That you may do what I told you. That you may be what I proclaimed you to be. That you may be what I created you to be. I've empowered. I stand up here with authority, God says, to make anyone great that I choose to make great. To abase anyone that I choose to abase. And I chose to make you great. Look at the Bible at those who God chose to make great. It worked. If they cooperated. They went through some challenging times. I promise you, you will not go through any more than the children of Israel went through instead of getting their inheritance. Hallelujah. Batea Shipota. Where God has you, don't be captivated by it. Don't be distracted by it. Don't.
Just keep walking, praising him, thanking him for his provision, thanking him for his molding, shaping hand, because you acknowledged him, and behold, he's leading you. Huh? Oh, we're doing our part, but God's coming up short. Acknowledge me in all your ways, and I shall direct your path. It stands forever. Nothing's going to change that. Nothing can change that.
It's Father's word. All you got to do is get passionate about being used by God. Oh, God, I don't want my life to be spent on vanity. I don't want my life to be spent for myself. When you purposed your glory to be revealed through me, when you purposed to honor me, when all my value and meaning of life and existence, you've handed to me as a free gift in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. I pray you get stirred up. I pray that you understand that Jesus is looking for anyone to agree with him. That agreement has to come not from our ideas, but from his word. It's not a far away. We don't have to go search God out. God, somebody go find him. Send out a scouting expedition. Have some special prayer meetings, spiritual warfare to break open the heavens, oh God. Has been done. The spiritual world isn't like it was in the days of Daniel anymore. That's nonsense. It's nonsense. Satan been drop kicked out. Prince of the power of the air has been separated fully. Hallelujah. We've been translated out of the kingdom of darkness. Amen. We've been delivered. Say, I delivered. From darkness. Translated. What a translation. That's a better translation anybody ever had. Than Elijah had, or Enoch had, or anyone. I've been translated in the kingdom of the dear son. Just come on, people. If you just begin to grab a hold of this, you start believing the things that God has said about you. Listen to me. I'm talking to you. Because the hand of the Lord is upon you. Father sorted you out. Place his hand upon you. Yes, you. Don't give me that Gideon look. Gideon's like, who, me? Yes, you. Hand of the Lord's upon you. You can step up big in Jesus. Forget about what you've done and who you are. Look at what Jesus did and who he is for you. When we become so captivated by our Savior, something begins to change in our life. We can be captivated by what he did for me, who he is for me. He describes the meaning of his existence, the very value and meaning of his existence, to continually live just to pray for you. You can't miss. You cannot miss. You can't go wrong here. To be kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed. Come on.
Let the good times roll. Amen.
Don't get bogged down in the sorrow. Don't get bogged down in the things that belong to fear, the things that accompany doubt, the things that are in partnership with unbelief, the things that are in partnership with uncertainty. Uncertainty comes out of fear. Oh, no. But perfect love cast out the fear. How's your love made perfect? Just knowing and believing it, that God is love, and hallelujah, hallelujah. He that know, and just receiving that love, just knowing and believing the love that God has for you. Huh? Can you bask it? Can you just go ahead and bask in that for just a minute?
Yeah.
Huh? The Holy Ghost will bring it. So I'm trying to believe. Holy Ghost is looking for an opportunity to show you. You don't have to try to figure it out. He's looking for an opportunity to show you
how great the love of God is for you. And herein is our love made perfect.
Because when you know He's on your side, every day becomes, every day of our existence is about how we live fully for Him. How we take everything that He has placed in our charge in every dimension, because it really in reality is all spiritual, even the things that are tangible and natural, it's all spiritual, and we use it in the service of the Master. Hallelujah. Come on now. This is what we're doing. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Just stand over here commanding my house. Amen.